I started working on the Holocaust first in paintings and then in wall hangings in 1987. That was shortly after my husband died. My husband was in the American Air Force, and he was among those that liberated the camps, and he saw some of the camps in 1945, and it had a very strong effect on him for the rest of his life. But I think also my own personal experience during the war made me interested in dealing with the Holocaust, because even though I was not in Europe and I was not in the Holocaust, nor was my family, I still knew a lot of people who lost loved ones at the hands of the Nazis. And all during the war from 1939 to 1945, we in Israel heard bits of information about what was going on in Europe. We heard about the camps, we heard about the ghettos, we heard about the killings. And I'm sure that that had a very strong effect on me.
A boxcar, all boarded up, except for one small window through which appears the face of a girl. The contrast between the massive boxcar and the fragile image of the girl conveys the isolation and dehumanization of the individual in the Holocaust. This is a scene from a concentration camp. Prisoners are staring through a huge fence. They all look the same. Their pose, their clothing, their faces. The individual lost in the mass. Another aspect of the depersonalization that took place in the Holocaust. A wall hanging is different from a tapestry. In a tapestry, threads of different colors, or perhaps different thickness or texture, are woven together to create the images. In these wall hangings, the process begins with a background fabric, solid or patterned, here a boldly patterned fabric. And images are created by a variety of means, in this case mainly by applique. The faces were created by a repeated block print.
When I create my art, I just think about what I want to say and what are the best means of saying it. I think what are the shapes and what are the colors and what are the patterns and textures and so on that I might use to express what I have in mind.
There are 40 wall hangings divided about equally between maps and scenes. The maps show a specific place at a specific time. This map shows the continent of Europe in 1945, at the end of World War II, as one big graveyard. The dehumanization that took place in the Holocaust, a direct result of Nazi racism, led to the death of millions. The various countries are strewn with bodies, and some of the concentration camps that helped cause this are indicated. The images of the bodies were done by means of linoleum blocks, which were carved and printed on different pieces of black fabric. Each country is a different black fabric, appliqued onto the background. The same image of a body is printed again and again on the wall hanging, underscoring that what happened in the Holocaust happened across Europe. This map of Europe shows when the different Jewish communities that were destroyed in the Holocaust were established. Some were over 2,000 years old. The red lion, the Lion of Judah full of life, shows when the community was established. The lion is gray and upside down, to indicate the community was destroyed. The repeated image of the lion is block printed directly on the background fabric. The red beads symbolized the bloodshed.
A single wall hanging may take 500 or even 600 hours to complete. I do every bit of the work myself. Not only do I enjoy the process, the carving, the printing, the sewing, the beading, but it also seems to me that the work would be impossible to delegate.
This map shows the area of Germany and Austria where violence against Jews erupted on the night of November 9, 1938. About 100 Jews were killed in that eruption. 1,000 synagogues burned, and many thousands of Jewish businesses looted and trashed. 5 years of Nazi power with its increasing discrimination against the Jews had preceded this event. Kristallnacht, the Night of Glass, refers to the shattered glass of Jewish homes, synagogues, and businesses. Broken glass is expressed here by a variety of means. Images of shattered glass are block printed on the background. Shiny silver fabric defines the area of violence, and hundreds of crystal beads are like shards covering the area.
I started being an artist when I was already in my 30s because when I went to college, I studied social studies, and then I went on to earn a couple of law degrees. And it was only later on when I felt that I needed a new way of expressing myself that I searched and eventually found art.
The reaction of many Jews to Nazi terror was an attempt to escape. But as this work shows, there was no escape. The St. Louis was a German ship that left Germany in May 1939, months before the outbreak of World War II, with 936 Jewish refugees aboard, all with certificates to enter Cuba. But when the ship arrived in Cuba, all but a handful were refused entry. They tried to get permission to enter the United States, but to no avail. So the ship, with its human cargo, turned around and returned to Europe, where most of the refugees eventually perished in the Holocaust. This is a map of the area of Eastern Poland and Western Soviet Union, where the Einsatzgruppen, special action squads of the German SS, were charged with the task of rounding up and killing Jews. You can see the routes the four different units took as they followed the German army in its advance east, and some of the towns where they killed Jews. Although there were only about 3,000 members of these special squads, one quarter of all Jews killed in the Holocaust died by being shot by Einsatzgruppen.
I used this patterned fabric for a background because the light shapes on the black background made me think of grave markers. Most of the appliquing in the wall hangings is done by hand rather than by machine. The works are so large and often so bulky that hand sewing gives me better control.
This map of Europe shows the plans made by the Nazi officials gathered at Wannsee in January 1942 to discuss the final solution to the so-called Jewish problem. The Jewish problem was the very existence of Jews, regarded by the Nazis as a threat to Aryan racial purity. The final solution the Wannsee Conference came up with was to kill every single Jew in Europe. The number of Jews in each part of Europe was noted, and the total was 11 million. So the plan adopted at the conference was to kill 11 million Jews. This included Jews even in unoccupied Europe, such as England and Ireland. Estonia, on the other hand, was marked by the conference as free of Jews, because the Einsatzgruppen had already killed all the Jews in that country. The Wannsee Conference represents a significant milestone. violence against Jews, which had gone from sporadic eruptions as seen in Kristallnacht to methodical murder as seen in the Einsatzgruppen, would now seek the total annihilation of the Jews.
Art is there as a tool of expression. It's not something that you do for decorative purposes. You want to give the viewer your idea about life, about the world, and if you see the world through dark glasses, that's what you're going to portray. And it seems that for me, the tragic aspects of life have always been predominant in my interest.
This map shows the layout of the Auschwitz-Birkenau camp, one of six killing centers set up by the Nazis following the Wannsee Conference. Auschwitz was designed not only as a killing center, but also as a forced labor camp. Here is the ramp where new arrivals were separated for life, which meant forced labor, and death. Most of those shipped to Auschwitz, like the old, the young, the mothers, were doomed to immediate death by poison gas. The map shows the gas chambers and the huts where those selected for forced labor were crammed. Of course, these people, too, eventually died from starvation, disease, and brutality. Auschwitz was the largest of the concentration camps, and this map of Europe shows the many roads over which people were transported to this death center. People were shipped from all directions, often spending days en route in crowded boxcars. The repeated image of the boxcars in the background, printed on rough burlap and appliqued onto the background, underscores the relentless pursuit by the Nazis of their objective. In the center is Auschwitz, punctuated by a glistening red bead.
In this map, I used red, gray, and black. To me, these are the colors that express the Holocaust. Red stands for blood and fire, gray for despair, black for death. This is the palette used throughout the wall hangings.
This map shows the function of each camp by the symbol attached to its name. Auschwitz was one of many camps set up by the Nazis during their 12 years of rule. While some camps were designed for forced labor, others were designed for both forced labor and death, or even for death alone. The skull signifies death-only camps. There were four camps set up specifically to gas all who were sent there. The result of the Nazis' policy of extermination was the death of 6 million Jews. This map shows how many Jews perished in each part of Europe. The number that appears on each of the large arms, reminiscent of the tattoo on the arms of camp inmates, indicates how many Jews were killed in that area. The total of 6 million is indicated by the arms around the border.
I used beads to express the carnage. The beads in this work are long and tubular with an irregular surface. They're reminiscent of trees that have been chopped down, a symbol for death. You want the audience to feel what you feel. And what you feel is that something is amiss in life. That there is a basic tragedy, a basic injustice, a basic lack of hope. And you can portray it by choosing any number of subject matter. You can speak even about a landscape, and you can show it as ominous rather than as sun-drenched.
There were some rays of hope during the Holocaust. there was some resistance to Nazi oppression in some of the ghettos and in some of the camps, as this map shows. The ghettos where resistance took place are indicated by the black patches, while the camps are shown by the red patches. The upstretched hand holding the Star of David symbolizes the resistance, the shiny star signifying hope. Jewish resistance to the Nazis took place not only sporadically, as in the ghettos and camps, but also in the services of the Allies. This map shows how many Jews fought against the Nazis by participating in the various armed forces of the Allies. The repeated block-printed image of the soldier represents Jewish resistance to the Nazis.
I was a teenager in World War II, growing up in Israel, and still remember the many young people, including a member of my own family, who volunteered to fight. At the same time, my future husband was serving with the American Air Force on the European front. They were all part of the effort to bring about Allied victory in the war.
This map underscores the fact that Jews were not the only targets of the Nazi policy of ethnic cleansing. Like the Jews, the Gypsies were also regarded by the Nazis as belonging to an inferior race and thus endangering by their very existence the racial purity of the Germans. Hence, the Gypsies too were targeted for extermination. This map utilizes the image of the hand, used by Gypsies to foretell the future, to convey the number of Gypsies murdered by the Nazis in various parts of Europe. The hand is block printed on velvet to evoke the exoticism associated with Gypsies. When we speak about the number of Jews or Gypsies who perished in the Holocaust, it is important to bear in mind that what we are talking about is individual human beings. This work is a map of a part of a building known as the Annex, where a teenaged girl called Anne Frank hid from the Nazis in occupied Amsterdam. It shows the second and third floors. The writing is a section from her diary, where she describes herself as feeling like a caged bird.
I have devoted several works to Anne Frank. One reason is that she's well known. She's easy for people to identify with, certainly easier than an abstraction like the number 6 million. Also, she was a child in the Holocaust, and as such, she symbolizes the 1.5 million children who perished in the Holocaust.
The layout of the city of Amsterdam evokes an image of a spider's web. It is made up of appliqued silver ribbon, glistening like a web. The likeness of Anne Frank was carved in graduated sizes into linoleum blocks and printed on separate pieces of fabric, which were then appliqued. Anne Frank's image appears trapped in the cobweb of the city.
I personally relate to Anne Frank because she and I were born the same year, 1929, which means we were the same age. She was in the Holocaust while I was not, and I've often thought it could have been me.
In this map, we step beyond the house and the city where Anne Frank hid during the Holocaust. We see the long journey she was forced to travel during her short life. From her birthplace in Frankfurt, Germany, she fled with her family to Amsterdam, Holland. After hiding there from the Nazis, she was caught and sent to Auschwitz, Poland. And finally to Bergen-Belsen, the camp in Germany where she died. She was not yet 16 when she died. In this map, her image, set against a backdrop of boxcars, becomes fainter as she nears her death in Bergen-Belsen.
It is strange to me sometimes that I did not get to deal with the Holocaust until about 25 years after I started doing art. But to me today, this is the culmination of all the many years of artwork that I did, both in terms of the subject matter and in terms of composition and technique and so on. So I like to think that all those 25 years were not totally wasted.
This wall hanging, called Remembrance, is a collage of images taken from many of the other wall hangings. The heads from Wannsee, the arms from the 6 Million map, the bodies from the Europe 1945 map. These are images of death, and this wall hanging is an introduction as well as a summation.
The dedication reads, "The Holocaust wall hangings are dedicated to the memory of my dear husband Robert Liebermann, who, as a member of the United States Liberating Forces, saw Dachau in 1945 and never forgot."